let's get started. Hi everyone, I'm Alanna Burke, and this is AI is here and it's everywhere. How do we know what's real and what's not? So my pronouns are she and her. I work at Amaze.io. I work on the Lagoon team. Lagoon is our application delivery system. I am the community manager. I do developer relations, and I also do our documentation. This is where you can find me on the internet, on Drupal.org and Twitter. I will never call it X. I am abrex626. You can also find me on Mastodon and on Drupal Slack, where I'm also one of the admins. You can find me at Alanna Burke. I just want to share some of my pets with you because we're going to talk about some heavy stuff. So the ginger guy, that's Marshmallow. I just got him a few months ago and he's the best thing that's ever happened to me. The calico is Brooklyn. And the one with their tongue sticking out is my semi-feral cat, Mama Cat. These are some of my guinea pigs. These are my girl guinea pigs. That's Betty and Gloria and Blossom, Bubbles, and Buttercup.
Are these all real?
I know. Are they?
Just going with your theme.
And then these are my boy guinea pigs. This is Joey, Doug, who weirdly became one of our company mascots just because he's silly and lets me do things like put headphones on him, and Fergus. And this is my dog, Layla. She's adorable. So what are we going to talk about today? Real quick, we're going to talk about what is AI. Why is it important to distinguish between AI and human content? We're going to talk about deepfakes. We're going to talk about how to tell the difference. We're going to go over some examples. We'll talk a little bit about some recent AI content in the news. And we'll talk about how to make AI content better. So, what is AI? Now, I want to preface this by saying that I am not super knowledgeable about the technical aspects of AI. That's not what interests me as much about some of the more human aspects. So this is just sort of an overview. So when we talk about AI today, we're going to be talking about generative AI that creates things like text, imagery, audio, and synthetic data. It also creates marketing content, books, videos, illustrations, voiceovers, articles, customer service chats, music, and Willy Wonka experiences. This technology has been around since the 1960s, but has been advanced significantly with the introduction of what's called generative adversarial networks, or GANs. GANs can enable generative AI to create authentic images, videos, and audio. So recent advancements in transformers and language models have played a critical role in making generative AI more accessible. Transformers allow for larger models to be trained on vast amounts of text data, resulting in more in-depth answers. Generative AI works by starting with a prompt, which can be in the form of text, images, videos, or other inputs. Neural networks have transformed generative AI by learning the rules from existing data sets and then relying on explicitly crafted rules. Oops, left the top one in there again. The benefits of generative AI include automating content generation, reducing effort in responding to emails, improving technical query responses, creating realistic representations, summarizing complex information, simplifying content creation. I actually, when I was working on this talk, usually my talk research is I find a whole bunch of links and then I summarize them and I put them in my outline. And I found hundreds and hundreds of relevant content for this talk. So I was like, well, why don't I use an AI summarizer for all of these links? And then I'll copy and paste the summaries into my outline and then I won't have to read through hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of articles and summarize them myself, which was really, really handy. So like I said, the history of generative AI dates back to the 1960s with early implementations like the Eliza chatbot. And as for the future, some proponents of AI believe that generative AI is a crucial step towards general purpose AI and possibly consciousness. There's no consensus on when AI will gain consciousness. Some predict it could happen by 2045, while others believe it could be much further off, with AI potentially reaching the intelligence of a dog by 2048. Oops, I meant to put that on a second slide. So, I guess we'll see. Some popular AI content generators include For text generation, there's ChatGPT, Jasper, AI Writer, and Lex. For image generation, we have DALL-E 2, Midjourney, and Stable Diffusion. For music generation, there's Amper, Databots, and MuseNet. For code generation, we have CodeStarter, Codex, GitHub Copilot, and Tab 9. For voice synthesis, there's Descript, Listener, and Podcast AI. And there are so many more, many of which just, you know, fork and build upon and use, you know, build upon other projects and use the same libraries and things like that. And then there's other kinds of content that you might not think about as much, like music, both generating compositions and doing weird stuff like creating AI songs and covers of songs in the voice of artists. I'll wind up talking a little bit about Taylor Swift in this podcast presentation because she's a really popular target for AI stuff, including, like I said, people do things like make covers of songs from artists. And if you don't know that this artist has never sung this song, you might not always be able to tell. Let's see if everyone can hear this. So if you don't know that Taylor Swift has never done a cover of Life is a Highway, that sounds pretty legit. It sounds like Taylor Swift singing Life is a Highway. But if you're a Swiftie, you know that that's not her, and she's never sung that song. There are also really weird things that people do, like make songs in the style of artists with their AI-generated voices. This also was a big thing when Taylor Swift started dating Travis Kelce. People wrote a bunch of like football-related songs that were by Taylor Swift and then put them in her voice, and they were all over the internet. And then they wrote AI articles about their AI songs and published them on the internet, and then they wrote listicles about their AI articles about their AI songs. It was all very, very strange. And then there's social media videos. So influencers claim to make significant income by recycling content and using AI tools for viral videos, particularly on TikTok, with very minimal effort. There's a really complex ecosystem where they generate content from recycled material like Reddit and celebrity clips using AI tools and often low-wage labor too. So there's an industry that totally supports this trend, providing services like video editing, AI voiceovers, and monetization strategies through platforms like YouTube and TikTok. And many influencers and services promote the idea of getting rich quick by just getting, you know, viral videos using these AI-assisted videos, which usually involves content theft and no originality at all. And then there's books. So authors are discovering that their books are being imitated and summarized by AI-generated content and then published on Amazon. This is becoming concerning as it's difficult for authors to combat the ripoffs. Sarah Stankorb, the author of Disobedient Woman, found summaries of her book appearing on Amazon shortly after its release. She was disturbed by the lack of care and sensitivity in these imitations, which to her seemed to be generated by running the text just through a thesaurus program. The similarities between the original text and the imitation were blatant, with some AI rating systems confirming the likelihood of the summaries being AI generated. However, unfortunately, legally pursuing these imitations proves to be challenging due to the inability to copyright book titles and the nuances of fair use. While some copyright scholars argue that summarizing a book is legal as long as it avoids word-for-word plagiarism, others believe that selection of arrangement of topics as well as similarities in language make it harder to defend. So the need for legal clarity in this matter is exemplified by a 2017 case in which Penguin Random House sued authors over children's editions of their titles. And until a lawsuit is filed about this specific issue, the legality of AI-generated summaries is gonna remain uncertain. And we're gonna talk later about laws about AI. There was also a recently organized program by the Côte d'Ivoire chapter of the Romance Writers of America that focused on using AI in romance writing, which caused controversy among the romance writers. The program was titled From Meatbot to AI Do, Crafting Romances in the Realm of AI. And the program promised to explore the world of AI-assisted romance writing, featuring demonstrations and practical advice from an experienced romance author who had been using AI to help write for over a year. However, the program received quite a bit of backlash from writers who felt that it undermined the work of authors who write their own content. In response to the criticism, the Romance Writers of America posted a statement on social media affirming their commitment to supporting authors and intellectual property rights. And the controversy surrounding this program comes after recent legal action taken by two authors against OpenAI and Microsoft regarding more of the same, more copies, more plagiarism, more books being summarized and sold online. So, next up, AI or Photoshop. We'll talk a little bit more about this as we go into some examples, but I wanted to mention it now. The line is blurring, as Photoshop now has generative AI features. So for the purpose of this talk, when I say Photoshop, I mean a human editing photos. Pete Souza, who was the official White House photographer during the Obama administration, recently posted about the use of the term Photoshop when photos have been altered. And he asked that people call fake and altered photos what they are and stop using the term Photoshop when virtually every professional image has had its color and lightness and balance tuned, because that's within professional journalism standards and what we call Photoshop generally is not. So that's also something to think about as we consider the language we use as technology evolves. And along the lines of this, in January, Georgie Purcell, who's an MP in Australia, was upset to find that a news station had edited her to have a midriff and a bigger bust, which the network then blamed on automation by Photoshop. And they claimed that during the process, the automation by Photoshop created an image that was not consistent with the original. This did not meet the high editorial standards we have, and for that we apologize to Ms. Purcell unreservedly. But a spokesperson for Adobe said use of its generative AI features would have required human intervention. They said, quote, any changes to this image would have required human intervention and approval. So I think we're probably going to see more of this, people photoshopping things and then trying to backtrack and blame it on AI. So, why is it important to distinguish between AI and human content? There are a million reasons. Here are just a few. Frankly, it's annoying. I don't know about you, but I feel like social media is absolutely flooded with fake images, and then I feel the need to, like, someone's wrong on the internet. Like, I have to tell people that they're AI. I do a lot of animal rescues. You can see I have a lot of pets. And so many of my animal groups get these AI-generated animals posted, and people are like, oh, they're so cute, where can I get one? I want to adopt one. And they're like, you can't, they came out of a computer, they're not real. So it's just sort of, it's clutter and it's noise, and that can be frustrating. It also obviously can lead to disinformation, to scams, to fake news. It's also important to know the provenance of the content that we consume. Where did it come from? Who created it, which is also then important for upholding ethical standards. You know, if something is plagiarized or it's, you know, incorrect, how can we correct that and get back to the truth if we don't know where it came from? And again, with plagiarism, protecting intellectual property rights. So let's talk a little bit about deepfakes. Deepfakes are videos and pictures created using AI that look almost indistinguishable from real footage. They work by combining existing images, video, and audio of a person and manipulating that information into new fake content. Deepfake technology requires a large amount of data to create convincing images and sounds, so it's not just as easy as putting some prompts into ChatGPT. While deepfakes have been used in the entertainment industry for purposes such as de-aging actors or recreating deceased actors to finish a film or a film series, they can also be used for very malicious activities such as spreading fake news or creating non-consensual pornography. So why are they dangerous? We're going to talk about some not safe for work stuff here, but that's the nature of this one, and we're all adults here. Deepfakes, they can be used to create phishing scams that can lead to identity theft. Again, disinformation, revenge porn. Unfortunately, an emerging cybercrime trend uses fake videos of celebrities to promote fake products. And then, of course, revenge pornography and sextortion videos that violate people's privacy while either earning money selling the videos or by threatening to release the videos unless a ransom is paid. The prevalence of deepfake porn on the internet has significantly increased between 2019 and 2023, resulting in very serious issues for women. While there are many uses for deepfakes, like much of the internet, their primary use is for pornography. A recent report by Home Security Heroes reveals that 98% of all deepfake videos online are pornographic in nature. The accessibility of free and user-friendly tools has led to a 550% rise in deepfake volume. Notably, 70% of top porn sites also host deepfake porn. Most victims are women, and the consequences include, of course, blackmail, career damage, sexual assault, along with significant psychological impact like trauma, depression, anxiety. And unfortunately, there are limited legal options available for the victims of deepfake porn. Only a few states have laws against it, and even then, some only allow civil cases. So let's talk about deepfake laws. There is a bill that has been before Congress for a couple of sessions now. It's H.R. 5586, the Deepfakes Accountability Act. It's defending each and every person from false appearances by keeping exploitation subject to Accountability Act of 2023. And its goal is to protect national security against the threats posed by deepfake technology and to provide legal recourse to the victims of harmful deepfakes. Taylor Swift, again, was recently the victim of a deepfake porn attack on Twitter. This incident caught the attention of the White House, which expressed alarm and called for legislative action. Microsoft also took action by updating its software to prevent the creation of explicit images featuring celebrities. Taylor Swift is one of the very few people who has the money, power, and influence to affect a change in the laws around AI, and I know that I personally would like to see her speak up and take action. Unfortunately, the laws haven't caught up with technology, and deepfake porn isn't illegal like you think it should be. But a few states do have laws about it. So in California, in 2020, the state passed a law allowing victims of deepfake pornography to sue those who create and distribute sexually explicit deepfake material if the victim did not consent to it. Florida, in 2022, the state passed a law that prohibits the dissemination of sexually explicit deepfake images without the victim's consent. Georgia, 2020 state law banned the online dissemination of falsely created pornographic images or videos. Hawaii, in 2021, the state outlawed the intentional creation, disclosure, or threat of disclosure of non-consensual sexually explicit deepfake images or videos. In Illinois, the law allows anyone falsely depicted in sexually explicit images or videos to sue the person who created the material. And victims can sue for damages and, to maintain their privacy, can use a pseudonym in court. In Minnesota, a 2023 state law made it illegal to create sexually explicit deepfakes and to use deepfakes to influence an election, very important. In New York, 2023, the state banned the distribution of pornographic images made using artificial intelligence without the consent of the subject. Texas, in 2023, the state made it a Class A misdemeanor to create sexually explicit non-consensual deepfake videos. In South Dakota, a 2022 law made it a Class 1 misdemeanor to create deepfake pornography of an unwilling victim. And in Virginia, the state law was passed in 2019 as part of an existing law relating to revenge porn, and the update adds falsely created videographic or still image. Unfortunately, I do not see New Jersey or Pennsylvania on that list, and I would like that to change, please. So let's talk a little bit about how to detect deepfakes. Can we just wait for questions at the end? So deepfakes can be really unsettling. Sometimes they're pretty easy to notice. They just look weird, but sometimes they're very, very good. So some of the things you need to watch for is mostly, and again, since deepfakes tend to focus on replacing the face and the voice and syncing that up, we want to pay attention to the face. So pay attention to the cheeks and the forehead and how they move. Does the skin appear too smooth or too wrinkly? Does the age of the skin seem similar to the age of their hair and their eyes? Does everything kind of match up age-wise? When it comes to eyes and eyebrows, when they move, when they speak, do the shadows fall where you expect them to fall? If they're wearing glasses, is there a glare or a reflection? Does that move when the person moves? If there's facial hair or a lack thereof, does that look right? Do they have moles? Do the moles stay in the same place? Do they move around? Do they get bigger or smaller? When it comes to movement with blinking, do they blink enough? Do they blink too much? And when it comes to lip movements, a lot of what they do is they'll use, you know, part of the software will sort of it's sort of hard to describe. They'll make the person lip sync to the content that they're creating. So it can look weird and unnatural, but it can also look really, really close. So sort of, if you watch it and you get that sort of, you know, audio video disconnect, it looks like they're sort of oddly lip syncing. Take a look. It's very much sort of an art to get a feel for what's wrong. There are also, of course, tools to detect deepfakes. These are just a couple of them. Intel has developed a real-time deepfake detector called Fake Catcher that can analyze blood flow in video pixels to determine authenticity, because the way that your blood flows and your face and the colors that it makes are something that you can't really fake. It achieves 96% accuracy and can provide results within milliseconds. Operation Minerva is sort of a part of a, it's a larger service, but it uses digital fingerprinting to identify deepfake videos or revenge porn videos on many of the popular adult video websites. So basically you can sign up with them proactively or after something has happened, and they use your existing data to detect deepfakes on these sites. So they can proactively scan and make sure that if anything does appear of you, they can detect it and have it removed. Or if you are the victim of an attack, you can reach out to them and they will use their technology to detect and remove that content. And then Deepfake-O-Meter is a research project by the University at Buffalo, State University of New York, and they are doing a ton of research into detecting deepfakes. All right, let's talk more about telling the difference between AI and human-generated content. I thought this was a really good quote from an article in PC Mag. AI is a science, not an art, but catching it out is the opposite. So when you're trying to figure out if an AI image of people, if an image of people is AI, there's some very specific things you can look for. Most people know that AI is not real great with hands and fingers. They are getting better at this, but sometimes hands will have too many fingers. Like you'll look, you know, notice there's actually five fingers, or the fingers, or the hands aren't in the right position. Like they'll be backwards. They're holding something, but the hand will be the wrong way. Hair, the edges of hair and where it intersects with other objects. That'll look weird and blurry, and the AI is like, I don't know what to do with this, and it just does something weird and cuts it off or blurs it. Jewelry and accessories. Check to see if jewelry and other accessories are accurately placed. see if earrings are, you know, they're wearing two earrings and they're the same earrings. Sometimes necklaces, like there'll be a pendant here, but there's no chain, it doesn't go anywhere, it's just floating. AI will also sometimes just add random bits and bobs and accessories and things it just kind of thinks looks nice, but they don't have any, it's just completely random. It doesn't make any sense. They're not attached to anything. Too perfect skin. Even compared to very, very filtered photos, AI skin just doesn't look quite right. The lighting and the smoothness, it's just not realistic. It's too, too perfect. Teeth. Take a look at the teeth. There'll be too many teeth, or there'll be the wrong kind of teeth. Like you'll have front teeth all the way across and no canines. The teeth are way too white, way too straight. They just look like psycho veneers or something. And mirrors. If there's a mirror in the image, the reflection will often be wrong. In more generic detection, vet it the way you would vet any other image. You know, go look at the metadata, do a reverse image search, see if you can find this image anywhere else. Look at the backgrounds. AI likes to just kind of blur the background and put some little pretty colors in there and see if it can just make you believe that there's stuff going on back there, but when you kind of zoom in and look at it, it doesn't look right. And if you're looking at an image that looks really, really cool and super impressive and you're like, oh, how did they do that? If it looks totally impossible, yeah, it probably is and a computer made it up. When it comes to buildings, look at misaligned architecture, oddly curved walls, unrealistic lighting. Sometimes in rooms you'll look at things and there'll be like multiple things that exist on the same plane that can't possibly exist there. I've seen this in, I was trying to find the picture and I couldn't find it when I went back and looked, but a lot of times on Zillow and stuff, you'll see housing listings where they've generated AI content inside of the housing listings. And the furniture just doesn't make sense. It's all very strange. Sharp, overly rendered appearance. Everything just looks too good. And sometimes this is hard because we can also do some of this with filters and making things look really nice, but everything just looks so completely perfect. Just too good to be real. A garbled text. AI likes to create this sort of weird alien language when it's trying to do stuff, especially if there's like a building in the background that has, you know, like the name of the building on it. It'll be in like weird characters that don't make any sense. And then just a logical piece of the image. Like I was talking about accessories, like AI will just put things in places because it thinks that things should be there, but they don't make any sense. I want to read a little bit from a post where someone explained point by point what was wrong with an AI image. This is, the point here being that on close inspection, many of the sound decisions made by the AI were actually complete nonsense. The questions of why is this here, what does this do, and how does this work are questions that the AI can't even ask or even consider. In order to get an image that removes all of these uniquely computer-driven aspects, one would need to train a model for an impossibly long time with today's computing power. The AI tries to create meaning in the form of imitation, but only succeeds in making something that looks good, but in reality is just a collection of pixels. All of this is to say, look for parts of an image that are confusingly unclear for seemingly no logical reason other than the lack of context. Computers don't know how to make things imperfect. I think about this a lot when I think about self-driving cars. It's easy to make a car that follows the rules, right? But humans aren't perfect, and we don't follow the rules. You know, a lot of fatal accidents with self-driving cars have been pedestrians or cyclists that appeared in the car's way and the computer didn't expect that to happen because that's not in the rules. And so it didn't know what to do. I know that's a simplification, but you kind of get the point. Detecting AI text. This one I personally think is sometimes a little easier. It doesn't flow naturally. It just kind of sounds weird and stilted. It'll often use lots of big words. Like we were talking about the AI plagiarism that just sounded like it was run through a thesaurus. It'll also have patterns and repetitions or identical sentence structures. There'll be a lack of coherence and natural transitions. There'll be, you know, one sentence about one topic and the next sentence is just about something totally different and it doesn't transition at all. They may neglect grammar and punctuation rules. And the information will be very, very general, with no specifics. You'll get a whole article that just doesn't dive into anything deeper than the headline. And there are lots and lots of tools out there for detecting AI images. These are just a handful of them. Now, let's talk about a few examples of AI content. Do you guys all remember the 2001 Great Cascadia 9.1 earthquake and tsunami in the Pacific coast of US and Canada? This is a screenshot of a video from an event that never happened. Recently, someone did they were just doing a Midjourney sort of experiment art project, and they posted on Reddit, and it got to the front page of Reddit, and from there it sort of escaped. And it started spreading, and people didn't realize that it was an AI project. Because honestly, if you were just looking at this and you just thought it was a news story, you might not notice things. Oops, look, there's George Bush. All sorts of terrible devastation, collapsed buildings. Firefighters, that whole harbor's on fire. That was terrible. Don't you guys remember that? Look at this guy just driving through that devastation. Oh, all these people are so sad. All those boats sank. I think that's the Canadian Prime Minister. These are all fake. And once you start to look, you start to notice things. The ones that I noticed the most, and the one that people flagged, do you see those hands? Her hand is not in the right direction. Her thumb is, it's not right. And the other thing that I noticed were the cars seem to be a mix of, why are these all 80s cars? And some of them are also too new. This also seems shockingly clear for a screenshot of a video taken at an airport in 2001. But overall, if you were just looking at this image set, would you notice that these are fake? I thought this was really, really interesting. And obviously, they pulled from a lot of 9/11 inspiration and imagery. Again, with the 80s cars. That car is in like every picture. But yeah, I thought this was really, and well done and interesting. That truck doesn't look right to me. And then you can also see stuff like as I was talking about with words, like look at that marquee. It looks like they're trying to put letters there, but it's kind of garbled. That street sign is unreadable. So once you look at it, it looks like there's gonna be words on there. You think it's gonna say something like deli or cleaner. There's no words. Look at her helmet. No words. So once you know what to look for, you start to see it. Such devastation. And And then we have the ridiculous content that pops up all over on Facebook. Oh no, why does it look like some of these aren't loading? So this is one of the examples of, if it looks too good to be true, it is. This little kid that supposedly lives in Africa or something doesn't exist, and he definitely didn't make this gigantic dog out of misshapen water bottles. Oh good, this is loading. Weirdly, a lot of the silly AI art is Jesus related, and I'm guessing that is for engagement purposes, because they will get 100,000 comments that say like amen on Facebook. And I just thought some of these were so silly, so I had to share them. Now, this one is silly and harmless because this is, I mean, even if this were New Jersey or Pennsylvania, obviously we're not fishing in the bottles. there's a whole series of like weird Jesus helicopter stuff. Jesus saving other Jesus in the helicopter. And this one, which is like cute, but like one, I don't think there's anyone living who's 122 years old, and like Granny's face looks real good for 122. Like she has no age spots, nothing, her skin's nice and smooth, and her like great-great-granddaughters look pretty weird in the background. more weird Jesus. Are there cool sand sculptures? Yes. Are they usually made by a cult where everyone's wearing the same outfit and worshiping the sand?
No.
More weird Jesus in a helicopter. What is even going on here? So those are just some weird ones that I wanted to share. And then I want to talk about a little bit about some AI content that's been in the news. So I mentioned earlier the Willy Wonka event. Last month, many people paid a good amount of money to attend a Willy Wonka event in Glasgow, Scotland, which was supposed to be this big, wonderful event for children that was going to be colorful and exciting and full of candy. And it seemed to just be an AI-powered attempt to scam people out of money. The website and the promo images were all AI-generated. And then the few actors who were hired were given these bizarre AI-generated scripts. And then they were in a nearly empty like warehouse space with a couple of sad backdrops and a couple bags of candy. People were furious. They called the police. Organizers canceled the event. And last I heard, the actors were not paid and no refunds had been given. So that's a new kind of AI scam.
Wait, an AI hired them?
It's possible. Maybe someone was doing one of those, how can I make money, give me a, you know, people do it to set up marketing stuff. So maybe they did get hired by AI. We have not gotten to the bottom of it yet. If you haven't heard about the mystery of the whereabouts of Kate Middleton, the Duchess of Cambridge, I won't go into it here. But last week, in an attempt to assure the public that she was fine, a very badly edited photo was released of her and her children, causing people to ask if it had been Photoshopped or generated with AI. To me, it looks like maybe a bit of both. Definitely some Photoshop, but there's also some really weird stuff in there that just, it has some of those AI qualities that we were talking about that don't look quite right. She did admit to editing it, so it's possible she used some of the generative features in Photoshop to do that. Some slightly older ones, Emma Watson, she's also been the victim of deepfake porn, but her voice was deepfaked to make it sound like she was saying racist things, including reading a passage from Mein Kampf. She, along with many other actresses and famous women, she has been targeted. And then there's some really bummer stuff, that's not a bummer, different kind of bummer. Hackers stole and rebranded a Facebook page belonging to a dog rescue called Marley's Mutts. The stolen pages were filled with AI-generated images, like the weird Jesus stuff, and then they appear real to unsuspecting viewers. And this, of course, impacted the organization's ability to find homes for their dogs. They expressed concern that without access to their Facebook page, more dogs could die. They had about 750,000 followers. I have been managing social media for rescues for years, and I would be so happy if we had 750,000 followers. I cannot imagine how devastated I would be if someone hacked our Facebook account. So they spent 15 years building their Facebook presence to raise awareness and support their rescue efforts. So the impact of these hacks really threatens the ability of small businesses and nonprofits to carry out their mission, and it's just to propagate more AI crap. And another Taylor Swift story, recently a voiceover was generated and lip-synced to a video of her telling her fans to get a deal on Le Creuset cookware. Needless to say, this was not legit. The New York Times wrote, "For now, Ms. Swift will probably continue to be a popular subject of AI experimentation. Synthetic versions of her voice pop up regularly on TikTok, performing songs she never sang, colorfully sounding off on critics, and serving as phone ringtones. An English language interview she gave in 2021 on Late Night with Seth Meyers was dubbed with an artificial rendering of her voice speaking Mandarin. One website charges up to $20 for personalized voice messages from the AI clone of Taylor Swift, promising that the voice you hear is indistinguishable from the real thing." And finally, let's talk about how we can make AI content better. So we've got some legislation. We've got the AI Disclosure Act, which is before Congress. It's Bill 3831, and the intention is to require generative artificial intelligence to disclose that their output has been generated by artificial intelligence and for other purposes. Companies like Adobe, and then there is the White House Safety Accord, where companies like Adobe, IBM, and NVIDIA have made commitments to the White House to develop AI that is safe, secure, and trustworthy. Other companies, including Cohere, Palantir, Salesforce, Scale AI, and Stability AI, have also committed to the White House. These voluntary agreements involve creating internal and external testing of AI systems, investing in safeguards, sharing information on risks, allowing third-party reporting of vulnerabilities, and more. The Biden administration consulted with leaders from other countries to develop these commitments as AI regulation is still being discussed. And then we have the blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights. Joe Biden has signed an executive order to establish rules surrounding generative AI even before we have any legislation passed. The order presents 8 key objectives: developing safety and security standards for AI, safeguarding privacy, promoting equity and civil rights, advocating for consumer, patient, and student protection, supporting workers, fostering innovation and competition, advancing U.S. leadership in AI technology, and ensuring responsible and effective government use of AI. Multiple government agencies have been assigned tasks such as setting standards to counter the manipulation of AI for biological purposes, establishing content authentication best practices, and creating advanced cybersecurity programs. Noteworthy points include the requirement for developers of large AI models to share safety test results. While an executive order is temporary, the Biden administration has already released the AI Bill of Rights, and agreements have been made with the various AI players, as we just discussed in the White House Accord. The order also emphasizes the importance of preventing AI discrimination and addressing job displacement, as well as supporting AI research resources and the rapid hiring of AI professionals within the government. Overall, industry experts have praised the order as a positive step toward establishing standards for generative AI. Then we have C2PA, I wrote it wrong, sorry. The C2PA is a joint development foundation project to collectively build an end-to-end open technical standard to provide publishers, creators, and consumers with opt-in, flexible ways to understand the authenticity and provenance of different types of media. C2PA opposes efforts to make content provenance measures mandatory. So OpenAI is integrating the C2PA metadata standard for labeling AI-generated images. It was established by tech firms to basically create a labeling standard for AI content. The metadata is not visible on the image, but is included in the file when it's downloaded. It can, however, be pretty easily removed, and OpenAI does acknowledge this, but it is a step towards establishing provenance and encouraging users to look for these signals so that we can increase trustworthiness in digital information. And from Google, we have SynthID. Oh no, I'm so sorry, this slide, I did not, I have it in the notes on the slide and not on the side. Google DeepMind's AI Lyria model is being used to create audio tracks that will be watermarked with SynthID, allowing people to identify their AI-generated origins. The watermark is undetectable to the human ear and remains detectable even when the audio is compressed, sped up or down, or has extra noise added. They also use it in images. It embeds a digital watermark directly into the pixels of the image, making it undetectable to the human eye, but detectable for identification. It's the first cloud-based tool developed by Google for creating and identifying AI-generated images responsibly. It is not foolproof against extreme image manipulations, but it's a promising technical approach. And Meta has also taken some steps. Facebook and its CEO, Nick Clegg, have announced a new approach to identifying and labeling AI-generated content on their platforms, including Facebook, Instagram, and Threads. So that's all I got. If you want to stick around for questions, I will answer them. So the question is, who's creating deepfakes, and where is the line between art and what's illegal? That I don't know, but like I said in the slides, most deepfakes unfortunately are porn. So I mean, the people who are
making money off of
that. Yeah, I think it is mostly a monetary enterprise. And that's what I think a lot of AI is. You know, even the garbage Jesus stuff is, it's on Facebook to generate clicks, monetize content. Same with TikTok and YouTube. It's just about getting stuff out there to monetize it. A lot of TikTok and YouTube is about like how long the content is and how long people can watch your videos. So if they can just get, you know, people watching your drivel for, you know, 2 minutes or whatever, then they make more money. And if it goes viral or whatever, then they get more and more money. So
my question is, like, so cars, right? Why don't they make cars that only go 80 miles an hour? That alleviates a big problem, but that takes away people's freedoms, right? Why is there a software out there that you can create deepfakes, or they're just building them themselves, right? Are they taking software that's out there or manipulating it? Do you know? Like, this is the stuff that you really like have to dig into, because I would like to know who's making these deepfakes and how are they doing it.
So the question is, why is the technology out there to create deepfakes? And I think that's just part of, you know, the ecosystem of open source. We want to use it for good, but a lot of people use it for bad. I think,
yeah,
you know, AI especially is a fascinating technology. It's an extremely powerful technology, and I think we can do a lot of good with it, but there's always going to be bad actors.
Right.
And I think, you know, legislation and best practices and I think a lot of it is going to come down to like individual moderation of things, like, you know, Meta cracking down and saying, you know, this isn't going to happen on our sites,
right.
Twitter cracking down and saying this isn't going to happen here,
right.
YouTube, TikTok,
right.
Until it's just not profitable to try and do this stuff. But that's going to take a lot.
Like, if you can do AI to do bad stuff, you can do AI to do the good stuff and pull the shit down, right?
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. So I was wondering if you had a chance to look at the European Union legislation that they just published this week. I was just on a quick look. It seems like they're going after companies like Facebook, punishing them, whereas I hadn't reviewed your stuff, but it looked like they were going after the people posting the actual content, the people generating content.
Yeah, okay.
Did I look at the European Union stuff? I did not, because I already had so much content to look at. But it did look, from the brief stuff I looked at, it did look like some other countries are taking sort of a heavier-handed approach to it, which I'm fine with. I would like to see, you know, I think there's a lot of things that Facebook should probably get in trouble for and needs to be slapped around a little bit. But I think it'll be interesting to see what approaches work best. And I mean, I think the EU is already ahead of, you know, the US with GDPR and privacy and things like that. So I would expect to see better results.
Yeah, since this isn't a Drupal conference, I wanted to bring up something that those of us in that space can do. So my organization uses AI extensively, mainly for summarization and chat. And we do two things. Number one, in our twig templates, we clearly label summaries that are generated by AI. And we also use taxonomy. We tag content that's been generated by AI because we don't know in the future whether that may be important. It's likely to be. We don't know yet how we would want to use that, those taxonomy terms, but at the very least, we at least know what data in our system has been created with AI. And those of us who, you know, are in a position to influence organizational policies by our choices should take advantage of the moment that we're in right now to set the tone for our organizations.
What organization is that?
I've worked for a legal entity that,
okay,
that absorbs that takes a lot of government data, complicated data, and we summarize it. Any organization, I mean, everybody is using AI at this point. And those of us who are rushing headlong into this space should try to set the tone for our organizations, because who else is going to do it in the absence of policy guidance?
Okay. Just for purpose of the video, I'll summarize that comment with just someone talking about how in their organization they're using AI to summarize things and also generate taxonomy terms, and they're making sure to indicate in all of their templates and such that that is all AI generated, so that going forward all of that is clearly labeled. Anybody else?
Yeah, so in your presentation you talked a lot about how we can use the human eye to determine, you know, what are certain clues that this may be a deep fake image or video. As it becomes more sophisticated, we may completely lose that ability. Will there always be some method, technical in nature, that we can determine if this is real or not? Or is that something that we will eventually lose as well?
I mean, will we always be able to detect AI content? I can't answer that. I would hope that as more AI content generators move towards being able to watermark, like, mark their content in a way that is unable to be removed, that even if a human cannot figure that out, that we will continue to have technology to figure that out. I also, I have a gigantic list of sources that I will publish when I publish these slides, and some of them will have links to, like, there's bajillions of research papers on how people are trying to detect AI content. And I think as long as those people keep doing that research, along with the AI developers continuing to do their part, I think we're on a good track to be able to continue to keep up with AI.
But it is essentially an arms race, right?
Yeah.
The technology